Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Mark, chapter 9, actually verses 2 through 8. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for he was terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. And this is the word of the Lord. And thanks be to God. And let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, be with us this day. May my words be your words. And may we take your words and put them into practice, now and always. Amen. There was once a man who followed a precise routine every day. His alarm went off at 6:30 a.m. He rose briskly. He shaved, showered, dressed. He ate his breakfast, which was two soft-boiled eggs, wheat toast, and a glass of V8 vegetable juice. After breakfast, he brushed his teeth. He picked up his briefcase. He got into his car, drove to the parking lot, where he parked in the exact same space, exited the car, and got on the local ferry. After exiting the ferry, he walked briskly three city blocks to his building and rode the elevator to the 17th floor. Upon his arrival, he said good morning to his secretary, strolled into his office where a hot cup of coffee was waiting for him. He hung up his coat and umbrella, opened up his briefcase, spread out his papers, checked his calendar for his first appointment, and sat behind his desk at 8 a.m., not 7:59 and not 8:01, but 8 o'clock on the dot. The man followed this routine every day without fail for 11 years, and then one day his alarm failed to go off. He woke up a lot later than usual, and he was in a panic. He shaved and nicked himself three times. He showered in such a haphazard manner that he never did get all the shampoo out of his hair. He dressed so quickly he didn't notice he was wearing odd socks. He ate his breakfast, which was two runny parboiled eggs, wheat bread, as he had no time for toast, and a big swig of V8 right out of the bottle. After breakfast, he brushed his teeth barely. He picked up his briefcase, got into his car, drove to the parking lot, where he took the first available space. When he exited the car, he watched in horror as the ferry was 20 feet from the dock. Instead of being defeated, the man ran down the dock towards the ferry at full speed. Reaching the edge of the pier, he gave an enormous leap from the dock, over the water, and on to the ferry. He had jumped so high and so hard that when he hit the deck, his body immediately went into a somersault. The captain of the ferry came up running and said, "That was the most incredible thing I've ever seen. You must have been some well-conditioned athlete in your time to be able to do a move like that. I just have one thing to say. You do know the ferry's coming in and not coming out, don't you?" Even though he had some encouragement, the man in our story showed great courage and strength in a time that was, for him, adversity and panic. All of us would like to think that we are a pillar of strength and calmness in tough times. We see ourselves as strong, capable, reliable, responsible human beings. However, there are times when we need strength and courage to face the incidents that life can throw our way. In today's scripture reading, we learn of the transfiguration of Christ. Now, at this point in Mark's gospel, Jesus is beginning that road to Jerusalem. The events of the cross are beginning to unfold, and Jesus knows that what he must face up to is getting closer and closer. He takes his inner circle of disciples with him, and he goes up on the top of a high mountain, and there he is transfigured. The three disciples saw that Jesus' clothes had become a dazzling white, and standing with him were Elijah and Moses. When the disciples saw that Jesus was talking with Moses and Elijah, it must have convinced him that this truly was, without a doubt, the Son of God. This meeting also did something for Jesus. Here he was talking with two of the giants in Jewish history. Moses, the one who brought God's law to the people, and Elijah, the one who brought God's voice to the people. Now, we are not privy, we don't know what the three of them did or said or what they were talking about. Possibly these two men were encouraging Jesus with what he was about to face up to, letting him know that he could do it, he could get through it. But in that meeting, I'm sure that Jesus received strength from God in meeting with these two men. He was given a comfort that no matter the outcome, Jesus had the courage needed to persevere. He was giving a blessing that in his darkest moment, he knew that God was with him. And he was given an assurance that what he was doing was the right thing at the right time for the right reasons. And on that mountaintop meeting with Elijah and Moses, God gave Christ exactly what he needed. And God gave the disciples exactly what they needed. In verse 7 we read, "Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, 'This is my Son, the Beloved, listen to him.'" God gave the disciples Jesus. They needed to follow him, to learn from him, to grow from him, and they needed to listen to him. They needed from Jesus that presence and that stability that they could not get from anyone else. God gave his children what they needed, a loving, courageous Savior. And finally, God gave Peter in that moment what he needed, that mountaintop experience. Peter on the mountaintop, surrounded by God's glory, did not want that experience to end. He wanted to set up camp and stay in that moment. He wanted to cherish that feeling for as long as he could. Whether it was fear or glory, it brought him closer to God. Peter felt secure in God and wanted to keep that feeling forever. The transfiguration gave Jesus an assurance that he was on the right path. It gave the disciples the comfort of having Jesus with them in their life. It gave the disciples a moment to be in God's glory. God gives each of us the same mountaintop experience so that we can stay on the right track when we need that moment in our lives. First thing is, God gives us an assurance. An assurance that we're going to get through this, an assurance that we're going to be okay. Think of that time. It may be now, it may be in your past. Think of that time, that moment, if you're like me, you have lots of them, when you needed that assurance. You needed from God that feeling that you were doing the right thing, you were doing the right thing for the right reasons, at the right time. You needed that nudge to say, you're going to be okay. I assure you, you're going to be fine. God gives us that assurance every single day. That assurance from God comes from us when we get that idea in the middle of prayer. That assurance from God comes to us when we hear that small, still voice inside of us telling us what to do. We get God's assurance when that coincidence is just too much of a coincidence to be a coincidence. We get that moment of assurance when our loved ones and our friends are there just at the right moment and can do and say just the right thing for us at that time. We get that assurance from strangers. We get that assurance from the innocence of our children. We get that assurance when we've read a scripture verse 10 times, and on time 11, it hits right to what we're dealing with right then and there in our lives. We can feel God's presence and assurance in a certain song, in a certain worship service, in a certain setting in our lives. God is always there, working in our lives, nudging us, giving us those assurances each and every day that whatever we're facing, we're going to be okay because God is with us. The second thing that God gives us is he gives us Christ, that in this scripture verse, in a very special way, the heavens opened up and a voice said, "This is my son, the beloved, listen to him." Those three simple words are so important to us. And you notice there's only three words. The heavens didn't open up and God didn't say, "Listen to him when you're ready. Listen to him when you feel like it. Listen to him after you've failed, when you've exhausted all other possibilities." The command is so simple, it says, "Listen to him." I don't think there's any question that we all know and believe that Jesus is a living presence and is part of our lives. That's why we're here, to explore that, to better that, to work with God in our lives. But I don't know that we always take the time to listen to Jesus. When we're overwhelmed, when we're overworked, when we're overtired, when we're overstressed, when life is boring and mundane, when we need that extra push to get us through, we need to take the time and listen to Jesus and let Jesus come in and take care of us. It's very important we sometimes forget to simply take the time to listen to Christ. And the third thing that God gives us in this scripture is we get that mountaintop experience. Peter, it says in scripture that he was fearful. I think he was filled with that fear and awe. I think that he was filled with that moment where he felt very close to God. And he wanted that to be forever. He didn't want that to end. He didn't want to stop that mountaintop experience. And of course, that can't happen. Those mountaintop experiences are few and far between for a reason. God does that for a very special reason for us. If you've ever gone to a church camp in your life, if you've ever gone on a mission trip at some time in your life, or a church conference, I've done one or two mission trips in my life, either as a participant or as someone who has organized and led it. I haven't counted, but there's got to be 35 of them. I've at least done the last 18 years in a row consecutively with the church that I've come from. I've done a high school mission trip every year for the last 18 years. And they're wonderful experiences. Most of the adults that go on those trips have been with me, some of them that entire time, some of them 7, 8, 9, 10 years, because it's a week in their life that they never want to give up. It's a great week. This isn't me being conceited at this point in time. This is me showing that a lot of us have had these mountaintop experiences. You live as a family for a week, and I usually take about 50 people. And so you're living together, and you're playing together, and you're eating together, and you're praying together, and you're working for God together, and you're doing worship together every single night for 8 days. And you feel different. You feel closer to God. You feel that mountaintop experience, that slice of the kingdom, and you feel changed towards God. Lots of us has felt that when we've gone away to church events. And we come back from those events with that new feeling, with that mountaintop experience, ready to change the world. And we get back home, and we're home maybe an hour, maybe 2 hours, and then reality starts to sink in. And our parents are the same, our loved ones are the same, our problems are still there when we left, the routines and the chores and the dailiness of life is still there. We've had this incredible change, but no one else has changed. Everything else is exactly the way it was before you had that experience. And God gives us those experiences, those mountaintop glorious moments, so that we can survive, so that we can triumph in the everyday routines of life. If the mountaintop experience was never to go away, it wouldn't be a mountaintop experience. It would be an everyday event. God gives us that closeness and that glorious moment and that peace that fills us so that we can do the things in life that we need to do. So we treasure those mountaintop experiences and we use them to grow closer to God as we live for him in this world. Now, there once was a man who was very grateful to God for the life that he had been given. And so, in order to thank God, what he wanted to do was he wanted to, the day he went to heaven, he wanted to be able to present to God this perfect, clean life so that God would be very proud of him with what he did, with what God gave him. And so he decided that was how he was going to live his life. And he wanted his life to be pure and clean and unblemished before God so that God could be very proud of him at the end of his life. So in order to do this, he studied life so that he could make the best choices possible. And he saw that life was full of love, and this was a good thing. When people loved each other, they were happy. But love also had its cost. Love could be messy, and it could be painful, and it could be full of jealousy and envy, and it could cause a lot of hurt to the other person. And he didn't want his life so defiled in that way, and so he chose not to love, to keep his life pure. He also noticed that in life, life went better if people had a purpose, if they had goals. And this was a good thing because it allowed them to grow beyond themselves. It allowed them to grow closer to God. And he thought that was a good thing. But goals sometimes got in the way, and goals could be selfish, and goals could hurt other people. And sometimes what he noticed is the person who deserved the success in life got nothing, and the person who did nothing to earn the success in life were highly successful. And so he didn't want to go through that with his life. He didn't want to give in to that greed and that pettiness. So he didn't have any goals. And he also noticed that in life, life is more fulfilling if you help people. And this was a good thing, because if you help someone, it also helps you to feel better, and then you're both doing the right thing. But he also noticed that helping someone comes with a cost. Did it really help? If you gave money to a poor person, they seemed to remain poor. If you went on mission trips, they seemed to be in the same situations after you left. The people who wanted seemed to always want more and more and more. And so helping had a very selfish side to it. And he decided not to defile his life with that kind of ugliness. So he didn't help. And the man goes through life, and finally, as the story goes, as it's going to happen, finally he dies. And he goes up to heaven, and this is the moment he's been waiting for. He gets to go to God, and he gets to show God how proud he is and how proud God will be of this life. A life that has been pure and clean and undefiled from the ugliness of life on earth. So he goes up to God and he very proudly smiles and he said, "Here's my life," just beaming from ear to ear. And God says, "Life? What life?" Our lives are messy. And they're complicated, and they're hard to get through, and they're complex, and God knows this, and God is there every day to help us with this. God gives us his assurances, so that small, still voice, that nudge of speaking to us, so that we can get through this tough, hard life. God gives to us Christ, so that we can take a deep breath. We can feel that peace, and we can listen to him. And God gives us those mountaintop experiences so that we can face the everyday of life, so that we can get through, and so that we can help others do the same. That is a life to be proud of. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for what you give. May we work hard and strive to do everything in your name and for your glory, now and always. Amen.